This is NDTV, and you're watching NDTV 24/7.
Hello and welcome. As the world comes to terms with the reality that the battle with COVID-19 is going to be a protracted one and that we have to live with it till there's a vaccine or a cure, what are our next steps? India has also started unlocking, but the risk of infection is still high. Cases are climbing. Doctors are in the process of opening up clinics, and patients who need regular checkups and follow-ups are now planning to make these visits but are still worried about the risk of infection. People with chronic lifestyle conditions like diabetes need to start planning their regular follow-ups and monitoring tests. To talk about all of these, we have with us Dr. Ashwin Karuppan, consultant in general medicine with Gleneagles Global Hospital, Chennai. We're also joined by Dr. M. Ravikiran, a senior and well-respected doctor from Chennai who's a consultant endocrinologist with the SIMS Hospital in the city. Thank you both very much indeed. Now, Dr. Ashwin, let me begin with you. How do you see the current situation in India? Have we been able to successfully manage this situation in Chennai, your city, for instance? Cases have been going up alarmingly. How would you rate the current situation?
I would rate the current situation that it has been wonderfully handled by the government and by all of us as a supportive staff. This is possible for a few reasons. The first reason is being like we have been the last in the chain to be affected. And then we have a lot of data and the research which is coming up and then probably throwing a lot of light on the pathogenesis of the disease itself. So I think that it has been a great data and a research on a lot of medications which is going to improve and bring down the mortality rate. I think so far we have done extremely well and we are doing a very good job when it comes to bringing down the mortality rate and the spread of infection.
Dr. Ravikiran, would you agree with Dr. Ashwin's assessment? In your opinion, are we on top of the COVID battle?
Actually, the last 3 months' time has given ample time for doctors, hospitals and the public to imbibe a new health culture. Now, from the community point of view, public are also aware that we need to adopt certain hygienic measures and adopt social distancing, avoid crowding in public places and avoid touching surfaces unnecessarily. And when they come back home, they have to wash. All these measures have become part of our daily lifestyle now. So these 3 months have given ample time. Also, clinics also now know how the things are spread, fomites, all these things we are adjusted to know. We are able to take enough precautions in clinics also so that patients can freely come to clinic, meet the doctor and go back to their home in a safe manner without fear of contracting COVID during their visit.
So, Dr. Ashwin, specifically, what steps, in your opinion, should be taken and what steps are being taken by hospitals and their OPDs so that patients can be safe? Patients are particularly worried at this time. They see hospitals as the source of infection in some cases and have been staying away.
See, what we have done is we have put some standard procedure of operations. For example, when you enter at a hospital, there is a thermal scan which is going on, and there in most of the hospitals, they have a screening camp where you go to the screening camp and you tell them very clearly about your symptoms, any recent history of travel, why are you here today? And then probably they screen you, they give you some hand sanitizers, and then probably make you wash your hands if required. And then make sure that you have all adequate safety precautions, including a mask. And then you go to the billing counter where you will ask for your appointments, you give your appointment timings. And then probably there is a social distancing which has been maintained. And then from there, you go and be seated until you have been called. And all these arrangements are already being done by the hospital itself. And then even in the doctor's chamber, there is adequate distancing which is being kept between you and the doctor so that you do not contract infection from the from a doctor and the doctor doesn't contact any infection from you. And the examinations are also done in such a way that it is being done in a minimal contact way so that the infection do not spread with each other. And we know that when you wear a mask and sanitize your hands, probably that itself will bring down the infection by 95%. And this entire system is being followed until you exit the hospital, and including your pharmacy, where contactless payments have been brought into place. So I think the hospitals and the clinics are pretty much very safe to visit, and probably getting an appointment is a very good suggestion, so that you don't have to wait. We can avoid overcrowding at this point of time and spending a lot of time within the hospital campuses. So I think we are ready right now to go ahead with this.
Dr. Ravikiran, would you say individual clinics also need different protocols in place? Ventilation, for instance, you have patients coming in and out. Some of them might be using public transport. How would clinics go about this?
There are three or four areas to be looked at in particular. One is educating our own staff. So before educating patients, we have to educate our own staff. They should know how to keep up the hygiene. Second, we have put up posters and signages for patients' benefit, so that they know which is the safe measure to adopt. And third thing is ventilation. In smaller clinics, it is easy to manage ventilation because it will be single AC for single room. There won't be much air circulation across a large area. Exhaust fan has to be put up in extra, and the windows and the doors can be kept slightly open to enable extra inflow of fresh air, so that good air circulation is there. And humidity should be kept between 40% to 70%, and temperature ideally should be, if AC is working, 24 to 30 degrees Celsius. That will be the ideal temperature. The main thing is to improve the inflow of fresh air by keeping the door or window slightly open and using exhaust fans also. And fourth thing is the measures that you adopt when patients come in. There is a nursing staff in the entry of the clinic. She'll be inquiring about the fever and other symptom details. If a patient is having fever, we refer to a specified fever clinic. If the patient is having problems other than fever and cough, then the particular specialty doctor will be able to see. Before that, we give sanitizer for hand wash. We make sure the patient has mask on. And our staff will be wearing goggles, protective gown, all those equipments. And the chairs are placed further apart, 6 feet apart, to ensure social distancing. So multiple domains have to be looked at and corrected for effective clinic operation.
Obviously, no one can cut corners when it comes to health and safety of both patients and medical professionals who are out on the front line. They're seeing so many patients at this time. How do you, though, focus, since you're both specialists, I want to now specifically ask about patients who have a pre-existing diabetic condition or endocrinal disorders. Dr. Rashman, if I can ask you, how should these patients be managing their testing and monitoring? Is it at all possible to do this at home?
In most of the case scenario, the good thing is that we have a glucometer at everybody's home today. So checking the blood glucose and keeping it under control is just like a cakewalk. And most of the time, we ask our patients who are completely not under control, supposed to check your sugars regularly and report back to us. We have already have a system in place, even before this COVID, where these uncontrolled diabetic patients are constantly checking their blood sugars and keeping us updated on their sugar medications. We also do give insulin instructions for these kind of patients. So coming to the check, definitely you have to check your blood sugars and make sure it is under control. And now you know that the home collection is also possible, and even the COVID test itself can be taken at home. So doing a normal routine examination or a normal routine test shouldn't be a problem for a patient. When should you visit? That is where you should be a little bit cautious, because diabetes itself can increase your risk to COVID. And when you get sick, you can really become very sick. So you should always look for warning signs like a cough with phlegm, an uncontrolled temperature which is not going down, and probably you have a sore throat, a breathing difficulty, a burning sensation while passing urine, or any of those danger signs. Definitely you have to visit the clinic. because visiting the clinic is much safer for your health, and we can deal with the complications much faster. And when you come in very sick, don't be hesitant to visit the hospital if you require. But otherwise, I think that most of the control can be done at home. You should make sure you take your medications properly, do the exercises which is required even in the lockdown, do whatever the minimal exercise is needed, and don't feed on junks, and probably watch your diet, and then you should be perfectly all right.
So Dr. Ravi Kiran, let me extend that question by asking you to apply that same scenario to elderly people. Now, senior citizens are believed to be at far greater risk. So are there any additional safeguards for them? Can they be checking with doctors on teleconsultations? Should they actually plan visits, physical visits to clinics and OPDs at all?
Yeah, that's a very pertinent issue to think about. Many elderly people with diabetes also have high BP, cholesterol, maybe some heart condition, possibly bronchial asthma and other respiratory conditions. What we advise them now, unless they have very high sugar, giddiness, some foot ulcer, or episode of some giddiness, chest pain, or abdomen pain, stomach pain, or unrelenting fever, like 3-4 days fever is there, unresolved. Unless these serious conditions are there, we are not advising elderly people to visit hospital. Nowadays, because of advance in technology, we have the advantage of utilizing telemedicine. Glucometers are available from medical shops. We can check sugar at home itself. And automatic BP machines are available in medical shop. They can check blood pressure at home itself and inform to the personal doctor, family doctor. So most of these day-to-day situations can be managed from home. No need to visit a hospital. Except if there are severe symptoms like enumerated, no need to visit hospital. That is one part. The second thing is the patient should also focus on ensuring they have adequate stock for the next 1 month. Stock of medicines. For example, insulin or some heart medicine or some life-saving medicine. They should have enough stock that they should ensure. They should count and ensure. And the third thing, this is a period of very unique time. Diabetes control always involves risk of tripping into low sugar sometimes, sometimes going into high sugar. This part of life. At this point of time, even low sugar warrants going to hospital. So elderly patients should avoid low sugar situations also. They should eat in time and take the proper medications at time so that low sugar condition is also avoided. Fourth one, possible lack of exercise because of social distancing and other norms. What we can do simple exercises, stretching exercises. They can stretch their legs and arms, sitting on their bed, lying on their bed. And they can walk for 20 minutes in the morning, 20 minutes in the evening within their hall. Or if there is a public space in their system, then they can utilize that. Or in the terrace, they can walk. So even within the restrained environment, it is possible to maintain the diabetic scenario very well.
Right. All right. Thanks for that. We will take a very quick break at this point. When we come back, how to protect ourselves better as we get on with our lives in this new reality.
Knowledge Partner, USV, your reliable healthcare partner. Amity University has India's largest scholarship program, from which over 25,000 brilliant students have already benefited. Students with over 93% in class 12 boards get 100% scholarship, and students with over 90% get 50% scholarship. Join brilliant, like-minded students who want to be successful. Apply at amity.edu/scholarships.
नमस्कार। कोरोना के खिलाफ इस लड़ाई में सबसे ज्यादा जरूरी है लोगों की जान बचाना, और इसमें मुझे आपकी मदद की जरूरत है। लोगों को प्लाज्मा मिलने में तकलीफ ना हो, इसके लिए दिल्ली सरकार ने भारत का पहला कोरोना प्लाज्मा बैंक बनाया है। अगर आपको ठीक हुए 14 दिन हो चुके हैं तो आप भी प्लाज्मा डोनेट करके किसी भी कोरोना संक्रमित व्यक्ति की जान बचा सकते हैं। और हाँ, घबराइए नहीं, प्लाज्मा देने में आपको कोई कमजोरी नहीं आएगी। किसी की जान बचाने का मौका बहुत कम लोगों को मिलता है, आज आपके पास ये मौका है। मेरी आपसे प्रार्थना है, आगे आएं और प्लाज्मा डोनेट करें।
मदुरई से शिमला, पुणे से कलकत्ता, इंडिया के हर घर की जरूरत पूरी करने हर पिन कोड पर डिलीवर कर रहा है अमेज़न पूरी हिफाजत के साथ। बताइए कहाँ आना है? अमेज़न, आपकी अपनी दुकान।
The Sikh tradition of langar is about ensuring food for the hungry. No matter who you are welcome with open arms at the Guru ka langar.
इन्होंने शुक्र गुजार है मालिक का जो इन्होंने इतना साथ दिए।
लंगर का मैं ये वाहेगुरु का प्रसाद है।
डेली बांट रहे हैं, इनकी मेहरबानी, भगवान भला करे इनको।
Watch a special show on how the Gurudwaras have fed over 1.5 crore people during the pandemic. Dil Se Seva, Feeding Millions, Saturday at 11:30 a.m. and Sunday at 7:30 p.m. only on NDTV 24/7.
Imagine a pressure cooker whistles and this does not happen. Prestige Swachh makes it possible. Presenting India's first no-mess pressure cooker. Jo swachhata se kare pyar, wo Prestige se kaise kare inkaar?
Welcome back to our special show, Living with COVID. We're talking about how to live with a disease that now seems to be with us for at least the medium term in the absence of a vaccine or a cure. What do we do as India eases restrictions further and further and as cases continue to go up as well? We have with us Dr. Ravi Kiran and Dr. Ashwin. As people are returning to their offices, Dr. Ravi Kiran, can you advise on any special precautions that they should be taking in their journeys back to their workplaces? Not everyone has their own transport. So what do you do when you're forced to take public transport, be in a shared space with somebody for a long time? What precautions can people take?
The first step is to make sure you need to go to office at all. There are many professions where you can work from home and still be very productive. Second thing, whenever there is a necessity to go to office, whenever you use a public space, we should avoid laying hands on surfaces unnecessarily, for example, handlebars of doors or some other surface, and maintain social distancing, maybe 3 feet, ideally 6 feet. And whenever we reach the office, whenever we have used a public conveyance or whenever we have reached the office, avoid laying hands on the railings and handlebars again. As soon as you reach your room, make sure you wash your hands with either a sanitizer or soap with water, whichever is available. And of course, all of us have to wear masks whenever we step out. And even within the office, if you are a manager of an office, we can make things easier for your employees by thinking about, suppose if there are multiple departments under you, you can stagger their arrival and exit timings so that a lot of employees don't crowd in the office entrance at once. And suppose if there is a common office utility like a coffee table or there is a biscuit break, something like that, this can be served individually as packets instead of using the same coffee mug or same coffee pouring jar by everyone. So in general, wherever there is a possibility for crowding within the hospital, that can be discussed and avoided. And again, the same thing when we reach home, suppose if we are using a public transport, sit to yourself 3 feet away. If there is only seat for three people, one person here, in between middle gap, and again another person can sit. If there is seat for only two people, only one should occupy ideally in the current situation. When we reach home, again the same steps. Whenever you use a public utility service like lift or some other thing which you have touched, as soon as we reach home, we have to wash our hands, and if possible, take a bath with soap and water. And for persons who are working in hospitals, in addition, they have to immediately put their cloth for laundry and they have to dispose of the hospital ware also responsibly.
All right, so that's as far as medical professionals are concerned, clearly. But what about cardiac patients, those with underlying cardiac conditions? Should they be going back to work at all? They're clearly more at risk. If indeed they are going to work, what can they do to reduce their risks? Dr. Ashwin.
Definitely, they have to go back to work because the economical implications, as you know, that today diabetes and cardiac patients form half of the chunk of the entire healthcare. So when they return back to work, what I would suggest in most of the cases that wear a mask, practice social distancing, and be very careful at work, especially maintain adequate distance. And especially what I would suggest is the high areas, which are the keyboards, mouses, telephones, and then you have the lift switches in the lobbies. And then probably like your cafeteria area where you have a cafeteria machine. All these are called high areas. So these areas have a chance of spreading this infection rapidly from one person to the other. I would suggest using a hand sanitizer or probably having a standard protocol where you have a hand sanitizer for every table to table so that you sanitize yourselves more often. Or if it is unavailable, probably wash your hands. Don't take your hands towards your face or don't touch any of your unsafe areas over the face without washing your hands, and probably maintain adequate distance. Cover your face, nose when you sneeze and when you cough, and probably do all these precautions and try taking a separate set of clothes to your office. And when you come back home, please do not go to any nearby elderly, or probably don't even go nearby children until washing your hands or getting yourself a bath or trying to wash your face and hands and all of that. So make sure that you carry out all these precautions. Apart from which, as I told you before, diabetes should be under control. Do not skip your medications. Eat healthy. Take lot of green leafy vegetables and try to avoid junk food. And probably do the minimal of exercises so that you continue to stay fit.
Well, those are all very useful tips. Dr. Ravi Kiran, one quick last question to you. For those who have diabetes or cardiac conditions, would you like to share any specific tips or suggestions to help them deal with their condition, to manage them more effectively in these rather fraught times?
Apart from the physical issues, the main thing we have to keep in mind is, in our life, we keep seeing many crises. This too shall pass. So we don't need to get worried about too much about this COVID thing. At the same time, we have to adopt proper precautions to not to acquire COVID. As I told, if you have diabetes, get a glucometer. You can check sugar at home, maybe once in a week or once in 10 days. You can keep in touch with your doctor and keep informing him. As long as your fasting sugar is around 110, 120, and after food sugar is around 160 to 180, you don't have to worry. You are in excellent control. Similarly, for blood pressure control also, you can monitor at home. As long as it is around 140 systolic and 80 to 88 diastolic, you are in good control. You can continue same medicine. So if you adopt simple measures consistently over the next 2 to 3 months, we can easily go through this phase without any problem.
All right. Thank you very much indeed, both the doctors on the show today, for being so very reassuring and shedding so much light on the way forward as people start venturing out of their homes, and that includes going to doctors for consultations. It is also time to thank doctors and medical professionals who are at the front line of this battle against COVID-19. They've been doing this without thinking about their own health and indeed perhaps endangering the lives of their families as well. So all our gratitude to them. Thank you for watching, and of course we'll continue to get medical experts on this show to answer all your queries on how to live with COVID-19.